Ange, great to see you back in Australia. Are you looking forward to bringing your team back to your homeland, if not quite your home city?
Yeah, a bit surreal, to be fair, Simon. That yeah, obviously living on this side of the world, I've seen plenty of these overseas tours, and you know, I've sort of been a spectator or been involved with them at club level. But yeah, no, it'll be a special feeling. I've learnt that the Celtic faithful are flung far and wide, particularly here in Oz, and I think it's an ever-growing supporter base, so yeah, looking forward to it.
And you've said that you've seen a lot of these games come and go. You remarked in the press conference that you were determined that your team was going to put on a show, or will put on a show, for the Super Cup.
Yeah, and I think the timing of it helps that, because I mean, we'll come straight from playing a league game pretty much on the weekend to here. So, you know, sometimes teams will come here in their pre-season, and we know what pre-season's like, and they tend to be fairly placid affairs. But, yeah, we want to come over and you know, sort of play some good football. And, you know, Sydney FC obviously will be in season, so will Everton. So I think they'll be good games. I think they'll probably be played at a tempo, you know, a little bit higher than what normal pre-season or friendly games are, which will be great.
That first game against Sydney FC will be at the new Allianz Stadium. I'm trying to remember, is that a stadium that you had lots of success at or not in the past?
There aren't many I didn't have a lot of success at. I did pretty well in my time here. So, no, it's great. Apparently, both stadiums have been redone since I've been here. Shows you how long I've been away. But, yeah, looking forward to, like I said, a new stadium. Sydney FC always were a tough opponent, you know, whether I was at Brisbane or at Melbourne Victory for the year I was there, but I think I had the word on most time. Although they did stop our 36-game unbeaten run, so they've always got that over me as a football club. But yeah, always enjoyed the encounters there. I mean, they've got a good supporter base, and I'm sure they'll be out in their numbers on the night.
I think that was at Jubilee Stadium, wasn't it, the day they ended the 36-game run, not Allianz, but yeah. Anyway. You also play Everton, of course. A good chance to test yourself against an established English Premier League club.
Yeah, no, as you said, good challenge, and playing them sort of mid-season, they'll be similar to us. They, you know, probably would have played, you know, the week before, and you know, they've started, you know, their season. They had a good win on the weekend, and you know, they've got some good players in their ranks, and obviously Frank Lampard is the manager. So I think it'll be a good contest. We, you know, we played a couple of Premier League clubs in the pre-season last year, and you know, it's always a good chance to measure yourself against, you know, good opposition.
I assume you'll bring a mix of experienced players and one or two younger players, because some will be on World Cup duty. Which Celtic players in particular should fans look out for, perhaps, that might excite them?
Yeah, I think, you know, for the most part, anyone who's sort of watched us over the last sort of 14, 15 months will know we've got a pretty young group, and they've been developing, you know, through that. As you said, they're, you know, in terms of the World Cup, obviously our Japanese boys will be away there, and we've got a couple of others. But for the most part, the rest of the group should be with us. And you know, I'd hate to pick out one or two from the current playing group. But you know, I think over the next sort of, from when we get back, we've got 15 or 16 games before we get here, including four Champions League games, cup games, league games. So we'll be in good nick by the time we come around, and I'm sure the supporters will enjoy the football.
I want to talk a bit about what's happened over the last 12 months at Celtic since you took over. As I remarked in the press conference, when you first got the job, it's safe to say some were a little bit sceptical because they didn't really perhaps know who you were. Was that difficult for you to deal with at the outset?
No, it was normal, mate. You know, I think people here in Australia forget that there was quite a few that were sceptical about me every time I got a job, whether that was at club or national team level. And I had the same sort of thing in Japan. I think it's just more, again, just geography more than anything else, is that I come from the other side of the world, and what, you know, what would I know about football in Europe? And I guess all my achievements have been, you know, on this side of the world. So I've always tried to use that in my favour, in that if people want to underestimate me and what I bring, then that's great. You know, hopefully by the time they figured out that I can do what I do, then, you know, I've had success. And it's never really bothered me. I guess the positive thing for me was that the supporter base, you know, got right behind me from the start. You know, we literally had to build a new team, so I knew we were going to take a little bit of time to hit the ground and get going. At a club like Celtic, you're not afforded that much time, particularly coming off a year where we hadn't won anything. I knew I couldn't go to, this was not going to be a 5-year plan, you know, this was, I knew that in that first year we had to make some sort of impact and have some success, so I knew the sort of clock was ticking. But again, I thought, I love that stuff, mate, that's why, you know, that's the stuff that, you know, I love doing, I love that challenge, and, you know, fair to say that, you know, since then, you know, people have sort of warmed to me a bit more.
Having known you in a professional sense for many years, when you got this job, I sensed that this was the role that you'd been waiting all your life for. Is that fair?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Because I craved being in an environment where people are as passionate as I was about the game. And again, because I've grown up here, people just assume that I love the game. But I was obsessed with football, you know, from a young kid. That's all I ever thought about, read about, watched, participated in. And my frustration, particularly, you know, growing up here, was that that wasn't shared by the majority. You know, it was kind of a minority of the community that had that passion, and that was fine as I was growing up. Particularly, sort of, you know, at South Melbourne, it was, you know, the community we had there, or, you know, when I sort of, you know, got into the A League, and you know, there was still a strong football community that was passionate about it. But, you know, I really craved where it was all encompassing, and that's where I've landed, mate, because, you know, they're not supporters. I keep saying that, you know, the football club is an extension of them, of their family, and you know, we lost our first game in a year, and I can tell you that, you know, they're not too happy about it, and I love that, you know, and that's exactly where I wanted to be. It's a massive football club. It's got massive expectations. It participates at the highest level. It's like I said, it's everything I've craved. Yeah.
So with that in mind, and given that you've won so many trophies as a coach at all the clubs practically that you've been at, how big was that Scottish Premier League title win for you last year? How emotional was that for you in terms of your career achievements?
Yeah, look, I've said a lot of times I don't like separating them or ranking them, because every one of them, from South Melbourne to Brisbane to the Socceroos to Japan, they've all been hard earned and shared with like brilliant people. But I knew that, you know, at the age of 56, I was going to get one shot at having a career in Europe, and you know, I was determined to be successful, and I knew I could be. I've always had the belief that I could be. So to bring that back, and I knew what it meant to the football club as well, because going from winning sort of 9 in a row to winning nothing. Your greatest rivals have won the previous championship. They weren't, you know, they needed to feel that sort of feeling of being champions again, and to be able to provide that, what it did for our supporters of the football club. And then, and like I said, personally, you know, 25 or 26 years have been obsessed with trying to make a mark. For me as a person, as a football coach, I knew that winning something over there in Europe would sort of give me the sort of credibility I've sort of craved my whole career.
And if I know you professionally, I know that you'll be looking for the next challenge. Is that not only winning domestic honours again, but making more of an impact in the Champions League?
Absolutely, mate. I mean, it's, again, I've got no time to waste. You know, everywhere I've managed or coached, I've wanted to, you know, break new ground. I've wanted to do things that, you know, haven't been done before. And I've, you know, that's why I've always sort of cherished every bit along the way. And that's what I want to do here, you know. And, you know, we've had domestic success, but I want to make an impact in Europe. That's where the football club deserves to be. It's a massive football club, as I said. And it's one of the few that's actually won a European Cup, so it's got tradition in Europe, but in recent years hasn't really had the progress that it deserves. So that's what I want to try and do. You know, I just don't want to sort of, you know, use the being in the Champions League as a great experience. I want to be in there to make an impact.
And your success, of course, has started to attract attention from elsewhere. You've been already linked, excuse me, with one or two Premier League jobs. Is that something that is on your radar at some point in the future? Is it a league you'd like to coach or manage in?
I've never sort of thought that way, and anyone who knows me knows that I don't. I, what I'm doing is what's most important to me, and I've always tried to, wherever I am, have as much success as I possibly can, and whatever that takes me next, whether that, you know, takes me somewhere else or I stay where I am. But the football world's a funny world, you know. Last year, you know, this time I was favourite to get sacked by Christmas, so you know, you kind of know that things change pretty quickly in the game. And what's most important is that I have a real massive responsibility to bring as much success to this football club as I can, and I know if I do that, I'll be in a good space. For me, as professionally and personally, I'll be in a good space, and that's what I want.
I want to talk a bit about football in Australia. The Socceroos, of course, you were national team coach for a few years. Did you keep an eye across the World Cup qualification campaign? Were you as thrilled as everybody else when they qualified? Do you watch games as a fan now, or do you still find yourself analysing as a coach?
No, I've always been pretty good at still watching football as a fan. You know, I try and not sort of watch it from an analytical perspective unless it's something that's, you know, going to come across my radar. But yeah, I've followed the Socceroos, I followed the A-League over the last, since I've been away, last sort of 4 or 5 years. And yeah, I've followed the qualification process, and you know, the important thing is we're there again, we've got an opportunity again to go to a World Cup. And I guess from my perspective, and again, I was pretty consistent when I was national team boss, that I really want us to go there and make an impact. I think in 2006, after a long absence, we made it, and we made an impact. And since then, in 10, 14, 18, I think we've had missed opportunities to do the same. You know, I look back at, you know, Brazil with me, and we had a chance to knock off the Dutch, and we missed that opportunity, you know. And I think we need to go to every World Cup, irrespective, and sometimes the qualification process is not a precursor to having success at a World Cup. We're there now, so whatever's happened beforehand is irrelevant. What's important now is we go there and we try and make an impact, you know, leave an imprint. That's how you develop as a football nation, I believe, that, you know, every subsequent World Cup, you don't take just the joy of qualifying, which is obviously important, but you go there and you go, you know what, this time we actually want to leave a mark for Australian football, and there's an opportunity to do that this time, you know. Yeah, it's a tough group, but you never get an easy group at a World Cup, and, you know, I just hope that there's a moment out there this time that, you know, when the opportunity is there, we take it like we did in 2006.
Do we have the players to be able to do that? You just signed Aaron Moy, of course, who's probably one of the most experienced, most talented players in the group. Can he be the catalyst for a better performance, and does he have the personnel around him to be able to do that?
Yeah, look, I mean, that's always the challenge. I think, again, looking back at 2006, it's no secret that we had a great group of players who were playing at the highest possible levels, which obviously is a good foundation to go to a World Cup and make an impact. But, you know, we had a great group of players in 1998, and we didn't make a World Cup. And I reckon if that group had gone, I think they could have made an impact too. There's no doubt that since then, our sort of playing stocks in terms of the levels they're playing at has diminished, and that doesn't help. But, you know, I think when you're there at a World Cup, I certainly felt that in 2014 with Brazil. You know, I went there with a pretty inexperienced group, but there's something about Aussies, if you can build them up, irrespective of where they're playing, that if you give them the belief that they could take on anybody, that still prevails today. And I'm sure Arnie will try and tap into that. As you said, with Aaron, you know, I seen him, I signed him pretty much on the back of him being the best player on the ground against Peru, you know, and he hadn't played for ages before that. I mean, I've always known he's a great player, I've worked with him, but I just felt he's still got plenty in him. And yeah, since he's been with us, he's built his fitness up, and he's going really well, you know, and I think he's one that can make an impact. I'm hoping Tommy gets to play some games, Rogic, in the championship between now and the World Cup, because he's another one that can make an impact. But irrespective, I think it's just part of the Australian DNA that you go there, and as long as you have that belief, which I think sometimes I believe we haven't had, or we've lacked that conviction, I think we can still make an impact.
Would you have liked to have kept Tommy Rogic, or do you feel it was time for him to have a change?
I think, you know, with Tommy, I love working with him. You know, obviously I'd work with him at national team level, working with him on a daily basis. Was brilliant, because, you know, he's a great personality, he's a great player, and he's a legend of that football club. But, you know, people need to understand that he had, his whole adult career, he's played at the one football club. his whole adult life he lived in the same place. It's a very, very demanding football club to play for. Like I said, you lose a game in a year and you know about it. And I think just Tommy needed a change of scenery, just for himself, I think. And I was really respectful of that. Yeah, I would have loved to have kept him. I think he could have stayed on, but I just got a sense with him that the timing was perfect. You know, we were champions again. He was a big part of that. You know, he got a send-off game, and I think he just needed a new challenge for him to maintain the levels that he's had. And he certainly got that going to the championship. There's no place to hide there. That's a tough league. But knowing Tommy, I think, you know, he'll handle it well. And we need him to, because, like I said, I think if he can get some game time and his fitness up between now and the World Cup, he's certainly one. You can throw him in against anybody at a World Cup, and he'll back himself to do well.
I just want to finish off, Ange, with a couple of questions about the A-League. some of your contemporaries in coaching, Johnny Aloisi, won the championship last year with Western United. Do you feel as though there's a crop of coaches here domestically at the moment that could perhaps emulate what you've done and make the leap over to Europe?
That's the one thing I'm really sort of bullish about in Australian football is the coaches, I think. You look across the A-League and there's some fantastic coaches. As you said, super rap for Johnny A to win it last year, because again, he's had to fight his way in managerial ranks. He had an unbelievable playing career, but he hasn't had an easy as a manager. But that's great, because that's what management's about. It never changes. There's always challenges. You've got to prove yourself all the time. Great to see him win. And you got guys like Popper and Uffy, and I just love the fact that this current group of Australian coaches have a similar mentality to our greatest ever players, in that I can see that they're really passionate and determined to reach the very top, which means that the inevitable obstacles they're going to have, and there are massive ones. I'm a living embodiment of that geography and your passport unfortunately doesn't open too many doors. So they're going to have to fight their way to the top. Great to see Muskie doing well. Great to see Peter Klimovsky doing well. Some guys in Europe who are starting to carve careers for themselves. But the one thing I will say is the A-League's a great ground, sort of breeding ground for management in Europe. I do have to smile sometimes when coaches in Europe talk about their transfer frustrations. I'd love to throw a salary cap and limited foreign spots at them and see how creative they can get in terms of recruiting. So, I'm really optimistic. I think we've got some great young football managers, and hopefully, they do. Hopefully, I see them over sort of where I am at my side of the world sooner rather than later.
And are your former clubs still pretty close to your heart? Melbourne Victory, of course, under Tony Popovich, and Brisbane Roar. You still keep a special eye out for those clubs, or will do over the coming season?
Yeah, I will, yeah. Brisbane, obviously, I had an unbelievable time in Brisbane, and we did some pretty remarkable things. I still don't think people sort of get their heads around too much, whether it was the way we won our championships in both years, or just that unbeaten run, which, I've tried to explain to people overseas, they say, well, it's 36 games. But I said, sport in Australia is all about equalisation. They try and stop this. There's rules in place to not allow teams to do what we did. And, that group of players was just unbelievable to go for that length of time without losing a game of football. And so it's when you talk about my achievements in management, I still hold that close to my heart. And I had a great year of Victory. They got a pretty special supporter base, so to be part of that football club for that year, where we got close to getting to a grand final after missing the finals the year before. I do follow both fortunes. I follow South Melbourne, Hellas as well. So great to see Sydney United in an FA Cup final. That's the stuff I love about football in Australia. It's there's still that sort of those early seeds that were planted many years ago are still quite fertile in Australian football, which is great.
Just a final question. You obviously keep across what's happening domestically here, but where's the A-League at, do you think, generally, and what would be your advice if somebody came to you and said, what do we need to do to take it to the next level? This could be a long answer. Victory of Simon Nani, for example, Marquee's the way forward, but what are your thoughts?
So there's a couple of things. I think the one thing, and again, with Australian football, I don't think it's happened by design, but one of the positive things that happened, I think, over recent years, and probably a lot of it due to COVID and economic restrictions, is that I've seen a lot of young Australian players get an opportunity. I think that's massively positive, because that's what the domestic league should be about. It's about producing the next wave of talent that, that hopefully keeps the game growing. And I think that's been really evident. Now the challenge is, I think, for all the club is to get your imports right. I think any league around the world, when you bring foreigners in, they tend to, you know, not just raise the levels in terms of exposure for the game, but also just the playing levels, because even the local players then see what the best look like in terms of, you know, training, in terms of all those kind of things. And, you know, that's where sometimes I think we've let ourselves down in terms of, you know, the level of imports and the kind of imports we've brought in. And not just about the profile, because obviously, you know, Nani's got a great profile, and, you know, knowing what Popper's like, he's pretty thorough, and he wouldn't bring him in unless he thought he could still perform at the highest levels. So that's great, because it gets us exposure. But, you know, you want to bring in guys like your Broishes, Marishes, your Ninkoviches, Castros, because if all our clubs do that in a given year, you're going to have a top league, and that's how you keep growing. So that's the challenge for all the clubs out there, the managers out there, you know, get your business right there, and I think that helps the profile and the standard of the league.
Long way down the line, Ange, are we ever going to see you back in Australia coaching here? Not for a while, I imagine.
Yeah. Who knows? Like I said, I don't think too far ahead. But I love a challenge, as you know, mate. And I'll always go where the challenge is greatest. And I still got some stuff I want to conquer. But I'm 57, to be fair. I'm not 47 or 37. So there's limited years ahead of me. And you know, there's a run to the finish line that I want to make sure. Like I said, when I get there, I've done everything I wanted to do. So there's still some. Still some horizons I need to conquer.
Good on you, Ange. Be great to have you back in November. Thanks, mate.
Thank you. Good day.